Hello students, this is Swati Agrawal. We are going to continue in this video the previous chapter, that is the chapter number 11, The Human Eye and the Colorful World. So students, in the previous video we have already learned in detail about the human eye and the various defects found in the human eye, how it can be corrected, and the refraction of the light through a triangular glass prism. So students, we are going to continue after that in this video session. So students, moving on, let us discuss the dispersion of the white light by the glass prism. To understand this, let us perform one activity. What you have to do, just take a thick sheet of the cardboard and make a small hole or the narrow slit in its middle. Now allow the sunlight to fall on the narrow slit so that it gives a narrow beam of the white light. Now just take a glass prism, the glass prism which I have already discussed in the previous video, and allow that light from the slit to fall on one of its faces. What you will observe, students? You will find that a beautiful band of the colors. This because prism split the white light that is incident on it, and a band of the color is obtained. Now if you will see in the figure also, the blue light bends the most and the red light bends the least. So now here are some phenomena, that is, when the white light is passed through a glass prism, it splits into its seven constituent colors to form a band of the seven color. This phenomena is known as the dispersion. Now what is the spectrum? The band which we form, that is the band of the seven colors formed due to the dispersion of the white light, is known as the spectrum. Now there is an acronym for this, that is the vigor. It is a group of the alphabets that represents the sequential colors in the spectrum. Now also we have seen that the blue light bends the most and the red light bends the least. Why so? Because there is a one rule, that is, the angle of the deviation is inversely proportional to its wavelength. So that's why red is the least deviated color, as it has the largest, or we can say the longest wavelength. That means more the angle of the deviation, the less will be its wavelength. So red is the least deviated, so that's why its wavelength will be the longest. Violet is the most deviated color, as it has the smallest wavelength and is visible to the spectrum. So students, moving on, Sir Isaac Newton was the first to use a glass prism to obtain the spectrum of the sunlight. He tried to split the colors of the spectrum of the white light further by using the another similar prism. However, he could not get any more colors. Then after that, what did he do? He then placed a second identical prism in an inverted position with respect to the first prism, as you can see in the figure. This allowed all the colors of the spectrum to pass through the second prism. He found a beam of the white light emerging from the other side of the second prism. So what happened? This observation gave the Newton the idea that the sunlight is made up of the seven colors. That is the proof that the sunlight is made up of the seven colors. Any light that gives a spectrum similar to that of the sunlight is referred to as the white light. Students, moving further, now let us discuss in detail, that is, the total internal reflection and its various phenomena. So what is the total internal reflection? Students, when the light enters obliquely from a denser medium to a rarer medium, and the angle of the incidence exceeds or it is greater than the angle of the critical, the light reflects in the denser medium. So this phenomena is called as the internal reflection. Now, what are the conditions which are necessary for the internal reflection? In this, the light should enter from the denser to a rarer medium, and the angle of the incident, it should be greater than the angle of the critical angle, so that the light reflects in the denser medium. Now, what is a critical angle? The angle of incidence for which the angle of the refraction is 90 degree. Now, students, in the previous slide, we have already learned about the total internal reflection. So, based on that phenomena, let us discuss how the rainbow is formed. So, student, as you know that a rainbow is a natural spectrum appearing in the sky after a rain shower. It is caused by the dispersion of the sunlight by the tiny water droplets present in the atmosphere. A rainbow is always formed in a direction opposite to that of the sun. The water droplets act like the small prism. They refract and disperse the incident sunlight, then reflect it internally, and finally reflect it again when it comes out of the raindrop, as you can see in the picture. Due to the dispersion of the light and the internal reflection, different colors reach the observer's eyes. So, students, you can also see a rainbow on a sunny day when you look at the sky through a waterfall or through a water fountain with the sun behind you. Now, students, moving on, let us discuss the concept behind the atmospheric refraction. So, students, you might have observed the apparent random wavering or the flickering of the objects seen through a turbulent stream of the hot air rising above a fire or a radiator. The air just above the fire becomes the hotter than the air further up. The hotter air is lighter, that is, it is less dense than the cooler air above it, and has a refractive index slightly less than that of the cooler air. Since the physical conditions of the refracting medium, that is the air, are not stationary, the apparent position of the object as seen through the hot air fluctuates. This wavering is thus an effect of the atmospheric refraction, that is, the refraction of the light by the Earth's atmosphere on a very small scale in our local environment. So, students, do you know that the stars, when seen near the horizon, appear the slightly higher than their actual position? Do you know why? Just because of the atmospheric refraction. Since the atmosphere bends the star light towards the normal, the apparent position of the star is slightly different from its actual position. The star appears slightly higher, that is above, than its actual position when viewed near the horizon, as you can see in the figure. Further, this apparent position of the star is not stationary but keeps on changing slightly, since the physical conditions of the Earth's atmosphere are not stationary. Now, students, there is another phenomena, that is the twinkling of the stars. So, students, the twinkling of a star is due to the atmospheric refraction of the starlight. The starlight on entering the Earth's atmosphere undergoes the refraction continuously before it reaches to the Earth. Since the stars are very distant, they approximate pond-sized source of the light. As the path of rays of the light coming from the star goes on varying slightly, the apparent position of the star fluctuates and the amount of the starlight entering the eye flickers. The star sometimes appears the brighter and at the some other time fainter, which is the twinkling effect. So, students, why do you wonder that the planets twinkle? Have you wondered that the planets will twinkle? The planets are much closer to the Earth and are thus seen as the extended sources. If we consider a planet as a collection of a large number of the point-sized sources of the light, the total variation in the amount of the light entering over the eye from all the individual point-sized source will average out to be zero, therefore nullifying the twinkling effect of the planets. Now students, do you know that the sun is visible to us about 2 minutes before the actual sunrise and about 2 minutes after the actual sunset? Have you think of it? Why it happens so? This happens so because of the atmospheric refraction. Again, this concept has been came. So students, by the actual sunrise, we mean the actual crossing of the horizon by the sun, as you can see in the figure. That shows the actual and the apparent positions of the sun with respect to the horizon. The time difference between the actual sunset and the apparent sunset is about the 2 minutes. Now students, moving on, let us discuss about the Tyndall effect. So students, the Earth's atmosphere is a heterogeneous mixture of the minute particles. These particles include the smoke, tiny water droplets, suspended particles of the dust, and the molecules of the air. When a beam of light strikes such fine particles, the path of the beam becomes the visible. The light reaches us after being reflected diffusely by these particles. The phenomena of scattering of the light by the colloidal particles give rise to the Tyndall effect, as you have already studied this concept in the class 9. So students, this phenomena is seen when a fine beam of the sunlight enters a smoke-filled room through a small hole. Thus, scattering of the light makes the particles visible. So students, Tyndall effect can also be observed when the sunlight passes through a canopy of a dense forest. Here, the tiny water droplets in the mist scatter the light. The color of the scattered light depends on the size of the scattering particles. Very fine particles scatter mainly the blue color, while the particles of the larger size scatter the light of the longer wavelengths. If the size of the scattering particles is large enough, then the scattered light may even appear as the white color. Now students, let us discuss some of the phenomena based on the scattering of the light. So do you wonder why is the color of the clear sky is blue in color, and why the danger signals are always red in color? Let us find out the answer of these two questions. So students, the molecules of the air and the other fine particles present in the atmosphere have size smaller than the wavelengths of the visible light. They are more effective in scattering light of the shorter wavelengths at the blue end than the light of the longer wavelengths at the red end. The red light has a wavelength about 1.8 times greater than the blue light. Thus, when the sunlight passes through the atmosphere, the fine particles in the air scatter the blue color more strongly than the red color. Why so? Because the blue color is having the shorter wavelengths. So students, the scattered blue light enters over the eyes. If the Earth had no atmosphere, there would not have been any scattering. Then the sky would have looked dark. The sky appears dark to the passenger who are flying at very high altitudes, as scattering is not prominent at such heights. Now the second question was that why these danger signals are always or generally red in color. Why so? Because the red is the least scattered by fog or the smoke, because it have the longer wavelengths or more wavelengths. So therefore it can be seen in the same color at a distance. Students, similarly, द अपियरेंस ऑफ द स्काई टू एन एस्ट्रोनॉट इन द स्पेस इज द डार्क इन कलर. वाई सो? बिकॉज द स्काई वुड अपियर डार्क टू एन एस्ट्रोनॉट इन द स्पेस एज द स्कैटरिंग इज नॉट वेरी प्रोमिनेंट एट सच हाई एल्टीट्यूड. As I have already discussed in the previous slide, just because of the absence of the particles in the atmosphere there. Now students, why the clouds appear the white? So students, clouds are formed by the water vapors. Water vapors condenses to form the water droplets due to the larger size of the droplets. All the colors of the light are scattered and the clouds appears to be the white. Now student, another question is why the color of the sun appears red during the sunrise and the sunset. While the sunset and the sunrise, the color of the sun and its surrounding appear red. During the sunset and the sunrise, the sun is near to the horizon and therefore the sunlight has to travel the larger distance in the atmosphere, due to which most of the blue light, that is the shorter wavelength, are scattered away by the particles, and the red light, which is having the longer wavelength, will reach to our the eyes. This is why the sun appears to be red in color.